I can say without a shadow of doubt that if someone told my 13-year-old self who I am today, I would never believe it. You see, India, or rather society in general, believes in a system of binaries, right? Zeros and ones, blue and pink, man and woman, doctors and engineers, and so on. Well, I didn't have an issue with at least one of those binaries when I decided to become a medical student. But the issue was, I spent the first 20 years of my life living as a man. And I realized if there was one thing that I wanted to be even more than a doctor, I wanted to be a woman. Because that's just who I always was. So you see, the last 6 or 7 months have literally been the most unpredictable time in my entire life. Because those many months ago, I decided to turn my medical, legal, and social existence completely upside down and start transitioning from male to female. No, but why would somebody do this? It sounds like such a drastic thing to do, right? This experience is not something that most of you, if not all of you, can readily understand. So today I will try to make that a little simpler. If you reach into your goodie bags, go ahead. If you reach into your goodie bags, you will find a ribbon. Okay, take a second, find it. You will find either a pink ribbon or you will find a blue ribbon. So I see some of you finding it, okay. Okay, those of you who've received pink ribbons, please raise them up for me. Okay, and those of you that have received blue ribbons, raise those up for me. Okay, so if you've received a pink ribbon, this day forward, you are a woman. You will have breasts, you will have a vagina, you will have long hair, you will be seen as a baby-making machine, and you will be a liability to your family. Okay. And if you receive a blue ribbon this day forward, man up, because men don't show any emotion, because men don't cry, right? And the size of your manhood will represent the size of your manhood, and so on and so forth. So if you look at society or India in general, this is what gender looks like. The day a child is born, you instantly seal their fate. You assign their gender, their psychology, their gender roles, and everything else. So show of hands today, how many of you feel like you've been assigned the wrong ribbon? Or you've been assigned the wrong gender? I see a few hands going up. Well, so now imagine if you had to live your life like this on a daily basis. The wrong body, the wrong roles. So the thing about that is, in medical terminology, what we call this is gender dysphoria, or more recently, we call it incongruence, okay? And what this means is that some people have a psychological gender which is different from their physical sex, and they experience a lot of discomfort and distress because of that, right? Now, you see how I use those terms, gender and sex, so specifically, even though we sort of very interchangeably use them on a daily basis, right? Now, that's actually incorrect. And when you do that, you actually confuse yourself even more. So let's simplify further, okay? Sex is what is between your legs, and gender is what is between your ears. So in other words, what that means is that sex is what your body says you are, and your gender is what your mind says you are. And for some people, those two things just kind of don't match, right? And that is called being transgender. So I was born biologically male, and I always identified psychologically as a lot closer to the female side of the spectrum. And that makes me a transgender person. And like many other transgender people, I experience that discomfort and dysphoria as well. And sexuality, what does sexuality mean? It's been such a hot topic of discussion thanks to the Section 377 hearings more recently, right? So your sexual orientation is, yeah, congratulations to all of us, I would say. If you read some of the documents, you will see that it's one of the most progressive things to come out of the Supreme Court, so kudos to us for that. So your sexual orientation is who you are attracted to, physically and emotionally, right? And today you see I stand here wearing a sari. Saris are probably the most beautiful thing I can say that a person can wear, but that's my opinion, of course. I think it's a very versatile garment. You can be as sexy as you want, you can be as modest as you want, and it fits every single shape and size, right? But different people have different ways of expressing themselves through their clothing, their hair, and their makeup, and so on. And that is called your gender expression, right? Now, these four things that I just spoke of, your sex, your gender expression, and your sexual orientation, each of those things, it's not binary, it's a spectrum, right? And what that means is that all of us sitting here fall at different points on each spectrum. And where you fall on one spectrum doesn't always determine where you fall on a different spectrum. A girl doesn't always like to have long hair. Me, for example, right? And I put this art in just to show you that human beings are an infinite number of permutations and combinations. And yes, I did create this, and you can see my old name there, which says Angad. So I made this a long time ago. And that diversity is what makes us all so beautiful. Right? Now, this last semester in college, I sort of spent trying to change everything on the outside to match everything on the inside. I started with my legal documents, I started my medical transition, I started dressing differently. Kind of sounds very simple, no? You just pop a few pills, go to sleep, change a few documents, and you're like this entirely new person. But it's most definitely not like that. Medical school and life in general, I feel, have been major roller coasters. And I remember I was on stage a few years ago, and I was supremely uncomfortable with myself. My parents were there. I think they remember. I was nervous and jittery and just very, very uncomfortable. So I kind of feel like, how could I make the stage my own when my own body did not feel like it was my own? But today, things are different. And I feel like on a daily basis, I gain more and more and more confidence to tell the haters and the people who judge me that they can go to hell. Right? But again, that's easier said than done, right? How did the medical fraternity itself receive my transition? Now, I have been lucky. I will most definitely say that. I have been lucky to have had professors and teachers who have supported me, who have encouraged me, but that's almost never the case. And if you look at India in general, like I said, it's almost never the case. Ever since I was a child, I can't count the number of times that I have been teased and harassed and bullied and so on and so forth, but I still maintain that one of the worst days of my life, or at least one of the most humiliating days of my life, was when I was asked to leave my anatomy class because I got my nose pierced. And that was in front of 250 students. Now, I wasn't in a position to explain myself because I didn't understand myself very well at that time either. But that really had me thinking, right? That had me thinking, how is it that doctors, the so-called intellectual people in the community, the so-called masters of human anatomy and physiology and so on, how is it that they know so little about the LGBTQIA+ community, right? And when I started talking to more and more and more transgender people, instances of violence, sexual harassment inside of the doctor's cabin, doctors refusing to touch transgender people, let alone treat them, these horror stories started to come up. And I really wondered then, what is the point of those fancy degrees that you frame and put on your walls? What is the point of all of that? The medical advances that we come up with. What is the point if you keep forgetting the most basic things that you swear by when you become a doctor? I solemnly pledge to dedicate my life to the service of humanity. I will maintain the utmost respect for human life. I will not permit considerations of age, disease or disability, creed, ethnic origin, gender, nationality, political affiliation, sexual orientation, race, social standing, or any other factor to intervene between my duty and my patient. So what happens to all of this when it comes to the queer community? And I realized that the problem is actually quite complex. It's not simply about society and social attitudes. It is also the medical syllabus. It is also medical training. many, many textbooks have such outdated and incorrect information about transgender people and the LGBTQ community in general. One horrifying text, for example, reads, "Lesbianism is practiced by females who are mentally deranged. They commit crimes like homicide, suicide, etc." So homosexuality is something that was not only decriminalized recently, but also declassified as a mental illness a long time ago in the ICD and the DSM and so on. Incongruence is no longer considered a mental illness either. But our doctors have been reading these texts for decades, for centuries. And so that kind of thinking has seamlessly transferred itself off of those pages into the minds within the medical fraternity, right? And the law has not always been on our side either. For example, a couple of weeks ago, I was a criminal. Perhaps many of you sitting here were also criminals, thanks to Section 377, right? But yes, the Honorable Supreme Court of India has read it down, saying that it is partially unconstitutional. But that is only one evil down. That's important to know. There are several more hurdles still to face. Right? Transgender people continue to be harassed by the law enforcement. They continue to be harassed by the medical fraternity. Change doesn't just happen overnight. And that is why I feel like it's so important to create some kind of change from within the medical fraternity as well. Yes, I may have joined my course at one point in time because I found the concept of surgery very artistic and beautiful. But I continue to pursue medicine today because I feel like the community needs more of us, right? And at the same time, I have been speaking to a lot of people. And by the way, one thing that I should mention right here is that India creates about 50,000 doctors every year. 50,000 doctors. That's an absurd number, right? And that's based off of an MCQ test. Now, out of those 50,000 doctors, I really wonder how many of them are truly capable of empathizing with their patients, of treating their patients, not like they were a bag of organs, but people, human beings with emotions. And perhaps that change will come slowly. I have spoken to a lot of people on campus and off campus, professors and students, and I have been lucky to interact with them and talk about these issues. And ever since I was a child, I have used art to express myself when I couldn't do it in person. But today, it's more of a statement that we are here, we are queer, and you better get used to it. So, and several other endeavors on campus, like TBH, we call it, which is To Be Human. It's a medical humanities initiative, and we try to raise awareness amongst medical students about the importance of empathy, right? So when I look into the mirror every now and then, and I just feel extremely uncomfortable with myself, or when someone says really nasty things on the road or even in the hospital, I try to remind myself that these efforts, they do make a difference. And when someone messages me on social media and tells me that they see me differently and they see queer people differently because of what I do, or when a parent messages me saying that they accept their child because of the information I put out there, I feel like, okay, maybe I'm doing something right. Maybe my faith in humanity is being restored little by little. But I still say about 50% of who I am today is my stubbornness and my determination to prove somebody wrong. But the other 50%, if not more than that, is pure dumb luck. I have been so lucky to have the kind of support that I do and to have the opportunities that I do. And that includes my supportive family sitting here today. And I think that's a big deal. Sure, it hasn't always been smooth sailing. I still fight with my mother all the time. But things are most certainly better than they used to be. And I think that I am very, very lucky when it comes to familial support. There's no question there. So all in all, I will say that it's been a roller coaster, right? Like I said, so many highs and so many lows, and an instance of transphobia today, maybe acceptance tomorrow, failures and successes and so on. All in all, I am a work in progress. I'm only getting started. I have a long, long way to go. And all I know is that thousands and millions of people like myself are fighting on a daily basis, not for your tolerance, but for your acceptance, right? So the next time that you see someone from the LGBTQIA+ community, set your inhibitions aside. Just have a conversation. See where it goes. After all, we are among you. We are your doctors, engineers, lawyers, artists, singers, and dancers. And yes, sometimes we are also the people that give you pleasure for a living because life has been cruel to us. But what I want you to take away from this is that above all else, we are human beings. And that, I believe, is an idea worth spreading. Thank you.